Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to the OCCULTURE podcast. Welcome to the show. Thanks for being here. I'm your host, Ryan Peverly. Just another line of code here guiding you through this consensual hallucination. I guess you could say I am your personal computer information on rap. And like the B.I.Z. Marquee says, I'll make your toes tap. Actually, that's my man Vestron Vulture making your toes tap with that theme music. Anyway, hey, our guest this time around, Stefan Kiesbye. He's the author of the recently released novel Berlingeles, a dystopian cyberpunk story that conjures up names like William Gibson, Philip K. Dick, Franz Kafka, and the television series Black Mirror. Stefan teaches creative writing at Sonoma State University in Northern California, and Berlingeles is his sixth novel. He's earned the moniker of the inventor of the modern German Gothic novel. And Berlingeles does have some Gothic tendencies, much like any 14-year-old just discovering Marilyn Manson, but it is really a story that reminded me more of modern sci-fi classics like Neuromancer and Snow Crash. It's set in a future Los Angeles that has been walled in, much like Berlin back in the day, and follows the stories of Gaz, a rising member of the city's most notorious street gang, and a 96-year-old man known only by the letter K. Here's a line from the synopsis of the book. Seeking a way out of this hellish maze of sweeping slums, waves of violence, and little hope, Gaz might just have found his path to salvation, while the underworld hangs on the prophecies of blind prophet Gerut and the rest of the lost city still smolders in the ashes of a civil war. Whew. And with a story like that, with themes like this, combined with Stefan's background, this made for quite the chat, so hopefully you take something positive from this. Maybe the following dialogue will help you tear down whatever wall has been built around you. Stefan Kiesbye, in the house, next.
The time has come to unshackle the beast that you have feared for so long. Relinquish your fear and submit to the cause. You will find all you need in these audio recordings. The year's 1990. Welcome to a culture.
Stefan Kiesbye, welcome to OCCULTURE. Really appreciate you being here.
Thanks for having me. Pleasure.
Oh, no, the pleasure's all mine, man, for sure. So, Stefan, you teach creative writing at the university level, and I
Yes.
studied creative writing at the university level, so we have something maybe in common a bit, except you actually do the writing, and I just learned how to do the writing. So, yeah.
Everybody who learns does the writing.
True. You know, I actually take that back. I always knew how to do it. I think university, college just let me know I was decent at it. Maybe I'm too cynical because I haven't been able to publish anything yet. But anyway, tell us a bit about how you got started writing creatively to begin with. Were you making up stories as a kid, or was this something you grew into as a young adult?
My first so-called, so quote-unquote novel I wrote when I was 4, I think. And I had a little notepad, and I knew about 3 or 4 words how to spell them, and I made up this kind of mystery story about a train in the dark and going past. And it was like 3 pages on a tiny notepad, but I called it a novel. And I was drawn to making up stories, but I didn't really get into writing until much, much later when I was sort of about 27. And that I really thought of myself, oh, I want to actually do this. This is something where I can see myself in.
Yeah, you know, I took a short fiction class just on a whim, and I got in there, and the feedback I got from my peers and the professor was so positive and so great that I changed my major right then and there. I haven't published anything, like I said, but I have written quite a bit on my own, just not anything I've really been, proud of to submit or finish, I guess. I have a lot of unfinished writing as well, so I think every writer does, right?
You have to. I mean, you have to write a lot, like, to get better, to find out what you're actually thinking on the page. It's always a good thing, though, to finish things, even if you later come to believe they're pretty crappy stories or it's a crappy novel. But to finish something is always good, just to make you think through that and not stop in front of the hurdle, but find a way to get over that. And the next time, hopefully, you get a little... you clear the hurdle a little more elegantly. What kind of stories were you writing?
Well, it's funny, man. Like, the stories were very much influenced by what I was, I guess, consuming at the time. So a lot of, yeah. Like, cyberpunk-ish, a lot of, like, drug-induced fantasies, which is funny because I wasn't doing drugs then. For some reason, my character was obsessed with, like, cocaine and just, like, womanizing, and he was just this real degenerate. So... I don't know what I was trying to express through there, but it was a sort of like low-tech sci-fi world, because that's what I was living in. This was like the late 90s, so, yeah. You know, tech was like, the internet was around, tech wasn't as advanced as it is now, obviously, so it sort of mimicked the environment that I was living in. But I was just, at 15 years old, I was writing about this guy who was a coke addict and just like a out and about doing whatever, and, you know, writing stories where he just... debauchery was running rampant. So, yeah, I don't know what your story was like when you wrote that novel at 3 or 4 years old, but I'm sure it didn't include cocaine or prostitutes.
No, it did not. I was not aware of that then.
Well, good thing. There might be some 3-year-olds now that are, which is terrible. So, speaking of your youth, though, you grew up on the German coast of the Baltic Sea, moved to Berlin as a young adult, and now you're in America and have been for more than 20 years now, since 96. Mm-hmm. How different do you think your writing style and your personality, I guess, would be had you grown up in America and not in Germany? I know it's hypothetical speculation, but hey, isn't everything, right?
Yeah, it is, of course, hard to say, but I think what really influenced me the most growing up in Germany was really Germany still grappling with the war, with the Second World War, with the Holocaust. And that cast really a long, long, long shadow over growing up. The area where my parents moved from the Baltic coast, we first moved to a small town in Lower Saxony. And where we lived, it was an industrial suburb, and it had been used during the war for producing ammunition. And so there were still the barracks where they had actually produced them. They had used bunkers for storage that the Allies had blown up after the war. So you had all these little hills in the woods. And as a kid, at first, we thought, oh, these are little hills. I mean, we didn't know better. And then we were later told, no, these are bunkers. And into some you could actually still get into. And so the war was constantly around there. And the generation of my parents who were little kids during the war and after the war really like kept quiet almost completely about that. They didn't even name it really. They always called it the bad time. They didn't even say, oh, right after the war or during the Wirtschaftswunder or any of that. It was always the bad time. And the problems they had witnessed and the politics of that time, their parents' own involvement in the war, that was all kept relatively quiet. It bubbled up once in a while. But their personal trauma and Germany's guilt over what Germans had done during the wartime was kind of kept quiet. We later learned about it in school, but this atmosphere of, as a kid, you knew something was going on, you knew something wasn't right, you always felt, shit, there's something really screwed up going on, but never getting straight answers really sort of colored my upbringing and my childhood, and it's still with me. And so if I had grown up in America, I think I would have grown up not feeling guilty about things, because America has a way of kind of skirting its own problems in strange ways, from sort of the conquest of the continent to slavery. There's always ways of making it look better than it really was. And in Germany, that didn't really work because, I mean, it was as bad as could be. And Germans were very well aware of that.
I've not heard the bad times phrase. Was that a common thing, or was that just in your family?
I think it was mostly in my family. It was a way for my mom not to think about it too much. For her, it was a very traumatic experience. She was living with her family in East Prussia, and they had to flee from the advancing Russian army. Her father died as a soldier during the war, and so she grew up dirt poor with her mom and her sister. They didn't have enough to eat at times. The village in West Germany, where they ended up, didn't want them. They didn't want refugees. So she grew up always feeling, this is not my place. People don't want me. And because of her experience also with poverty, like our freezer was always stacked up to here, and she always forced food on everyone, and she never got rid of that. It was so ingrained. And she never got over that trauma of growing up like that and what it had meant to her being an outcast in society. So that was a huge thing for her. And I think by calling it just the bad time, she could sort of isolate it, push it aside, not think about it too much.
Do you think that you sort of had some epigenetic trauma passed down unaddressed that you are trying to, I guess, maybe exercise or address in your own writing here?
It sounds weird to me always to like the whole trauma thing has so mushroomed in our culture that I always have a little bit of a hard time calling it that, because the word is losing its meaning a lot these days because people are using it for all kinds of things. But yes, I read a very interesting piece in the New Yorker 2 or 3 years ago about that. And I'm not sure that it's really epigenetic, but I think just living in a culture that keeps quiet about guilt, that keeps quiet about the trauma they themselves experienced, just creates a sort of a breeding ground for all kinds of weird atmospheres, weird conundrums, and probably affects you just as a kid. And the thing is, the more you know about it, the better you can counteract it. I mean, this is kind of has become pop culture, but if you read Alice Miller, if your dad slaps you, well, you always remember that. You know what you're angry at. But if your parents manipulate you, you don't have anything really to go on. It takes you a long time to see how they manipulated you. And so I think it's the kind of manipulation that was really hard to see and to really understand just how much my parents' generation swept under the carpet.
I think my parents' generation, which I don't know how old you are, your parents are, my parents are in their early 60s, late 50s, and I can see that, you know, like I could see how that generation was just completely consumed with, you know, from my perspective, getting that American dream with the house and the family and the car and the job with the retirement plan. And they totally ignored anything else that didn't further that goal of theirs. And then, you know, here I am, and people my age and younger are growing up with ancestry who just never really addressed their own shit. And I have some friends of mine who I have conversations like this with all the time that we feel almost like responsible for taking on that trauma in our own lives. And then also trying to help others, our parents especially, deal with their traumas as well without talking about it because they don't want to talk about it. They don't know how to access, I guess, the emotion or the language that's appropriate for them to discuss these things, especially with their kids. And I don't know what you think about that, but, and we're getting way far away from your writing here. I'd like to get back to that,
obviously. But it's true. You put it very nicely. It's my father just turned 80, so they never had the tools or the inclination to address any of that. It was really, you put food on the table, you have a place to live, you have a car, you have your family, and that's it. And it never went farther than that. And I think when they turned sort of 40, 50, they suddenly realized how much just was missing. But still, at that point, I think for many, it was just too late. And they just tried to muddle through, and it wasn't always pretty. I think you can't really solve the trauma of your parents. That's what they have to do. But yeah, it is being passed on, and you have to deal with it yourself the best you can.
Okay, so let's get past this trauma stuff ourselves here, and let's get back into your work. although it does sort of play a role here, you know, on some level. It has shaped your life, and this is, I assume, what you write about in sort of a subtle, sort of low-key way. But, you know, you mentioned Berlin and place, and that's really important in your writing background because you've been called the inventor of the modern German Gothic novel. And I'm not really sure exactly what that means. How is it different than the Gothic novels that I read when I was younger, those classic ones? You know, could you describe what a modern Gothic novel is? It any different?
The modern German one. There's a tradition of a German Gothic novel. E.T.A. Hoffmann, for example, wrote those. But and in northern Germany, we had a writer, Theodor Storm, who wrote those. But then people kind of forgot about that. And for, I don't know exactly, somebody will prove me wrong, but I will say, like, let's say for the last 100 years or so, there hasn't been really a rich tradition of a German Gothic novel. And so while I never set out to write a Gothic novel, I think my obsessions led me down that path. I always thought I was writing literary books that were really, really dark. But I see how it can be interpreted as a Gothic novel. And because I'm interested in the point in people's lives when they have to make a decision how far they're going to go to get something. How far are they going to go to defend themselves? How far are they going to go to defend somebody else? And whenever we get into situations where we haven't been before and that require us to act decisively, it becomes really interesting because then we see what we're made of, whether we are cowards, whether we have some bravery, whether we can tap into other resources that we didn't even know we had. So I think it's good that we talked about repression and keeping a lid on things because the Gothic lives off of the repressed. It's what we're trying to put down and trying to forget, but because we're pressing down on it so hard, it always finds a way to come back. And I think that's what happens in my book. People want to move on. People want to forget about the bad stuff, but it keeps coloring their lives. It keeps interfering with their lives. And it's always the young, mostly at least in my book, who have to take action to make things right, often by doing horrible things.
You know, I've heard you say in previous interviews that your writing is a study in place. And I've talked with some other writers on the show here about personality of place. I'm sure you're familiar with that term. You seem to be obsessed with this in your work, just from what I know. I've only read your latest novel, but from what I've read and researched about your previous novels, it seems to be a common theme here that place really is important thematically. What is it about place that you find so compelling? Why is it so important to you in your writing?
I actually didn't know about that. I had a good friend in Michigan who was with me in the creative writing program. And we were having coffee one day and we were sitting across from each other. And I don't know how we got to that, but at some point he was just saying, all your stories are about place. And I was, no, that's not true. And it's character driven and all that. And I was in heavy denial. And so over the following months, I was thinking about that because he's very smart. He's a really, really good reader. And I was, what if that's true? And I really discovered that all my stories really live off the location, that the context I'm giving my characters influences them way more than the other people around that. And I think growing up in this industrial suburb and then later in Berlin, you can feel the atmosphere. You can feel how certain things poison the atmosphere. And I really strongly believe that certain reactions, certain characters even, can only work or be brought about by a certain place. There's a certain meanness in places that you can feel. There's a certain exhilaration that you can feel in places. And that might be different for people. But when I go to LA, I feel a certain effervescence there. In other places, I feel really oppressed. And I can't always put my finger on that, but I can feel it very, very strongly and directly. And so I always try to talk to my students about that, because I think what we're experiencing right now is the polar opposite. I don't even know where you really live, how big your apartment or your house is, what's outside of that, none of that. We're meeting on the internet and we're experiencing a place without place, without a physical place. And that's how we do our business a lot. We text, we email, we Facebook, we Instagram, and often we don't know where people are, and we're all meeting in this no place space. And we often forget that, no, we're products of our surroundings. Like a love story in Berlin, where the facades are often still bullet-riddled, is a different love story than a love story in Tokyo, Japan. Is a different love story than the one in Mankato, Minnesota. It's always different because the context is different. And so place really determines who we are and how we interact with one another.
Yeah, you made some good points there that definitely pop up in your latest novel, not just with place, but with that common meeting ground where there is no place really on the internet. And we'll get to all of that. But your latest novel, we mentioned a couple times, or at least I have, it's called Berlingeles. It's far from German Gothic, despite the German sounding name there. It's out now. Yeah, it's out now from my friends at Revelor Press. Shout out to Jeremy and Jen. They're great people there. And, you know, I read the synopsis of this book on their website, and I invited you on the show here to talk about it after reading one sentence about it. I read nothing else about the book, no other reviews, no other blurbs, but I just read this blurb from Meg Howry. She said this. She said, Berlingeles reads like an episode of Black Mirror as conceived by Franz Kafka. And as they say on the streets, say no more, fam. I'm there with that. That's my jam. That's all I needed to know about the book, and that's why you're here. I've since read it, obviously. And to be honest, it's hard to disagree with Meg's assessment. But for the listeners who are unfamiliar with this book, tell them why your novel reminds at least one person of Black Mirror and Franz Kafka.
The Los Angeles I describe is a place where paranoia reigns supreme. It's a walled in city at that point, because America has lived through a second civil war and the Confederates are besieging Los Angeles, and the Union forces, helped by Mexico and Canada, are keeping a part of Los Angeles open. And that mirrors Berlin's fate after the Second World War. So Los Angeles is kind of reliving Berlin's past, but in its own very American way. And in that city, nothing makes sense really anymore. We also have this sort of advanced internet space called the Fleas. And the boundaries between the Fleas and what's actually going on in the city are heavily blurring to the extent that it becomes one reality all mixed together. There, through the Fleas, you can manipulate your surroundings. You can create what I call in the novel e-fiddy, sort of like an e-version of graffiti. You can alter your environment, and people lose lose kind of the ability to distinguish between the two. Also, these ephedes cause people who have artificial limbs to experience something I call the ghost storm, that they can actually feel the enhanced surroundings, the digitally enhanced surroundings. So I guess that part is the Black Mirror part, that we're living in a future that we all dream would be glamorous and beautiful and all that, but is actually highly dysfunctional. Yes, it's going forward, but people in Los Angeles at that time don't have the resources anymore to really make it glamorous. So it's already on the downturn. It's decrepit. There's a lot of poverty in the city. And so you have high tech, and yet nobody can make it work quite well anymore. And then you have the blurring of what is true and what is not, which we really experience right now more than I would love to experience, that people are calling out truths that nobody can verify anymore. There are two American presidents, and they're making claims about who has won what and who owns what territory, and nobody in the city can really verify anything of that anymore. It's becoming this very aggressive white noise. And that's really, to me, the most horrible aspect of that, to live in a world where there's no meaning anymore, because nobody can differentiate between falsehood and truth anymore.
Yeah, that's a great sort of big picture overview of what the book is about and the background of the setting and the history that these characters have to interact with. And I'm just curious if you could take us also through a more sort of streamlined synopsis of the major characters and their storylines and how they sort of intersect as well, because you do tell the story from multiple points of view with these different characters, and it's not hard to follow by any means, but just for the listener's sake, you know, if they haven't read it, they're interested.
Like, you wanted characters and I answered with plays, you know. I described the plays. So the characters, the main character, and that's really the starting point for me, at least, for the novel, is a 96-year-old former writer, K. He only goes by his first initial. And he is trying to stay alive so he can meet his one-time lover again. They made a pact 40 years ago that he would try to stay alive so at some point in the future, they were both married at the time, at some point in the future, they would be together. And so he does everything and anything to stay alive. So he has artificial limbs. He has his eyes scrubbed so that they don't fail him. He has he has artificial ears. He replaces slowly but surely his whole body in order to live on. So at some point, he will be reunited with B, who's also only known by her first initial. And then the other main characters are a young prostitute, Sophie, and her lover, who is a 16-year-old thug. He kills, he robs, and he does that for his boss, Rat. And the last of the characters, or the main characters, is Kang Jun, the detective, who is searching out K because he thinks that K killed his wife some time ago. And all these characters at first start out by themselves, and slowly but surely they're drawn together until all of them connect in various ways. And so from casting a wider net, it's getting more and more focused as we go along in the novel. And nothing good happens.
Yeah, that's the Black Mirror part as well, right? There's just, yeah. There's nothing redeeming about it, for sure. But it's
still, nothing redeeming about any of the characters,
right?
Either.
Yeah. So I don't like to talk about genre distinctions. I don't think they matter. It's more marketing than anything else, right? We know that by now. But I've seen this novel labeled as cyberpunk. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting label to slap on it. I first became familiar with the term reading the fiction of William Gibson and Neal Stephenson, the Neuromancer and Snow Crash specifically, and also films like Blade Runner, I suppose, as well. All modern classics, or maybe postmodern classics, of the sci-fi genre. I'm wondering if you had read, or were you influenced by, Gibson, Stevenson, Philip K. Dick, or any other texts or writers while writing this book, or while conceiving this book?
If I was influenced by anyone, it's certainly William Gibson, and not so much in the sense of the cyberpunk, which is debatable, and we can come to that later. Again, I wasn't sitting down and thinking, oh, I'm going to write a cyberpunk novel. For me, it was really about Kay trying to stay in life, and how would that work? And how is a society, how will the society work in 50 years? How will we change? What will happen? How will we change in our interpersonal interactions, or how will technology change? All these things. But what I love about William Gibson is that he's able to make adult characters look cool. In his trilogy that starts with pattern recognition, he's able to give us middle-aged people in their careers, like cool scouts, marketing people, all that. And he's not ratting them out. Usually in literary writing, so much of what we know about middle age sounds horrible. You know, like it's the loss of a child, the loss of marriage, the loss of home, disintegrating relationships, shitty jobs, all of that. And he found a way to really make middle age look awesome, look edgy. All these people are really still trying to do something. They had maybe success as young people, but that's not what defined them. They are still out. They're still in the game. They're still fighting for things. And that was really an eye-opener for me when I read that, much more so than Neuromancer, which I loved. But the focus on adult heroes that are actually heroes, kind of flawed, horrible, selfish, all that, but still they're in the game. And so to me, that was important because I have a 96-year-old character, and usually 96-year-old people, we might revere them in some ways, but we usually think, oh my God, they're going to be dead soon. You know, we hate age. Everybody in America wants to live to 100, but everybody hates old people. And that's so weird. I mean, we're trying to live longer. We work out. We take supplements. We do everything to live longer. But at the same time, we have such a horrible view of old age and old people. It doesn't make any sense. And so to have a 96-year-old character who is not dead, who's not boring, who has not given up, but is still striving to fulfill his own, let's call it destiny, that was really important.
Yeah, I agree with that, man. Why do we hate old age? I think it's probably because we see a lot of people, this probably goes back to what we started talking about with this ancestral trauma, who just, they grow old, they have these unaddressed issues, and it's not that they're old, because that's a relative term. It's that they're unhealthy. It's that they're depressed or miserable. It's just they're living these last few years of their life, you know, in hospitals and doctor's offices on medications. And it's like, for me personally, the exercise and the supplements and the proper nutrition are things I've taken more seriously here recently. But it's also because it's not really, I don't care to live longer. I just want my time here to be on my own terms, right? And I don't want to spend my time in those places that I've seen, like, you know, like my great grandparents and my grandparents spend their time in, you know, in those twilight years. So I don't know if that's a generational thing, but that's how I look at it now. And we don't need to go too far down that path, because I want to stick with the writing here. But if you have any thoughts on that, please throw them out there.
Yeah, I think it's, for me at least, it's really hard to look at people, let's say, past 75 and identify really the ones where I think, oh, wow, they're still cool. They're doing their thing. They're up and running. And I think that's what at least my generation, I think, is really lacking, or what I am lacking. These role models, I know one or two where I would go, fuck, they're in it. You know, they are as cool as they were when they were 20, 30, 50. You know, like they're still going. They're curious. They're doing all kinds of shit. They're traveling. They're trying new things. But I don't see that very often. And whenever I see it, it's a revelation to me, because then I think, oh, wow, that's what I want to do. You know, I don't want to, like, yeah, be bored, be sick. And of course, like, if you're sick, you're sick. Sometimes you can't help it. But to have this outlook on life that I want to still accomplish things, there's still things I want to do. And that's really what I'm hoping I'll say when I'm 75 or 80, if I get there.
Yeah, if I live to be 75 or 80, I aspire to be just as cool then as I am now, which is not that cool, to be honest, so it probably won't be too difficult. But let's get back to the novel here. There's also an element of, or you know what, maybe we should circle back to the cyberpunk thing. Was there more to say about that? You said we could come back to it. What was it about?
Oh, yes. So I think, in a sense, it is cyberpunk because I do talk about technology. I do talk about what future generations, how they relate to one another, what programs they're watching. I do that. But to me, that's, again, that's more a component of plays than really about just technology. There's not one element of technology that is so trailblazing that people will say, oh, we have to get there. I'm not redefining cyberspace. I'm not redefining any kind of other technology. To me, it's more like, yeah, our technology will evolve, but since I'm a pessimist, I also think that we will do ourselves in because we're not doing anything about climate change. We're not doing anything about poverty and so on and so forth. And so it's, a novel with elements of cyberpunk, but that's also, you could also call it probably a political novel or a gothic novel, a futuristic gothic novel, any of those things.
Well, you mentioned your pessimism. I'm glad you did. That's a good segue into my next question, that there is this element of this apocalyptic dystopia, which honestly has been prevalent in fiction for some time now, you know, for decades. Mm-hmm. Why do you think the apocalyptic dystopia has been so popular in fiction with both creators and fans? I mean, people seem to sure love this this sort of sad, gray bleakness. Why?
That's a really good question, and I've often wondered that myself, because a lot of my students' fiction is dystopian, plays in a world that was ravaged either by war or other catastrophes. And I once put that question to my students, why do you love this stuff? Why are you writing this? Why are you reading this? And I was really, really flabbergasted when the answer was, we want to know what to do when it gets here. So they were reading novels like The Road as a manual. What do we do when the apocalypse hits? How do we keep ourselves alive? How do we organize? What do we do? And that was really eye-opening to me. And so I think in my case, it's a byproduct of having Kay. I blame Kay mercilessly for everything that happens in the novel, because I wanted the character to be that old, to have to make do with modern technology, with artificial limbs, with new medications, with new medical techniques, that he uses everything at his disposal to just stay alive. Because we can extend our lifespan, but I think in 100 years, if the planet is still around, we'll be even better able to do that. And so all the technology that comes in there for me is an extension of what does Kay need to do to get to 96 and to live on past that. And to me, the dystopia is really coming entirely not so much out of, ooh, nice, a little dystopia and smoke and ravaged country, but it's really born out of what I see around now. We know our environment is going to shit, and we do zero about it. With the new administration, we're doing even less than zero about it. We're going even back to older policies. We are repealing measures that were supposed to protect the environment. And we all know, you can ask probably most reasonable people, do you believe that there's pollution, that there's climate change, that the rivers are poisoned, that the air quality could be better? Do you believe that? And they all say, yeah. I mean, some will say, okay, it's a Chinese hoax, whatever. But most reasonable people will agree that we poisoned this planet and it's overpopulated and that we're not doing enough to rein in those problems. But we're still not doing anything about it. And so my view is that we're going down to hell, open-eyed. We know, everybody knows exactly what they're doing, and we're we're still doing it. And so I don't see really any hope that we'll turn it around miraculously or find the miracle cure for pollution and other environmental disasters, for the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, or any of these things. We won't. We'll sit by while we're going to shit. And so my dystopia is not really about reveling in dystopia or zombies or flesh eaters or any of that. It's really, no, in 50 years, we'll be in a much worse spot than we are today.
Yeah, and you know, part of that dystopia, at least on the surface, and we'll get to why I think it's just on the surface here, but part of that dystopian vision is, you mentioned this wall around Los Angeles in your story. Obviously, that mimics the Berlin Wall as well. Although, to be honest, I think some people in our reality here may actually be okay with LA having a wall around it, if that was, you know, the truth of reality here. But be that as it may, tell people why, in your story here, why LA does have a wall around it, and what parallels that has with the other namesake of the book, Berlin. Let's just dig a little bit more into those parallels, and I guess why you chose LA as well.
To me, LA is the most fascinating American city. It's also the most American city, and of course, people have said that before. That's not really highly original or just me saying that, but it's a spread out city. It's the city that lives off of cars, whereas New York and Chicago are still much more European modeled. LA is really the American city, and it's a city of strip malls. It's relatively ugly, but you have the weather and you have Hollywood. And to me, Hollywood was a big thing. I say that at some point in the novel. It's really the dream industry. And of course, the film industry has moved on a little bit and other states have passed laws so they can attract filmmakers. But still, Hollywood is still the central sort of the part of the brain that makes us dream, that gives us rest, that spins the stories about ourselves, which Berlin was too before the war. Berlin and Germany had a bigger film industry than America did at some point. And through the war, that all went kaput and was never really recovered. It still hasn't recovered from that. So that's the first parallel. And then the wall comes in as a metaphor for a lot of things. LA is already a walled-off city in many aspects because every neighborhood that thinks it's a little more posh or just safer, quote unquote, has a wall around it. So many communities are entirely walled in. And the idea of the wall is really one that LA has completely embraced. People don't want to live with other people. They want to live in their tiny little enclave and be happy there, and then they want to press in the passcode, and then they go in there and they want to feel safe from the quote-unquote mob or other people. They want to have their privacy. And that's a really Southern California thing, Californian thing anyway. Even here in Northern California, every property has a fence around it. You know, like you go to the Midwest and there are no fences. Friends of mine live in Minnesota and there are no fences. You know, people's properties just are there and they abut each other and everybody knows where so the property lines on, but there are no fences. Here, everything is fenced off. And so I think LA really is the best city for that. And I think LA is also the city that for conservatives is sort of the thorn in their side. LA is in many ways the most liberal city. It's the one that reminds everyone that we should be maybe better. And it's where people think people are very hedonistic, very vain and all that. But it's also our conscience in many ways, in very surreal and absurdist ways. And so to have LA as the city that the Confederates want to overrun, but cannot because the Union forces say, no, this is too important, mirrors perfectly the situation with Berlin. Berlin was too important. I mean, the 4 million people or 2 million people that lived there in West Berlin were not that important. But Berlin as a symbol of this is our city, this is the free world, we can't give it up, that was important. I see the same importance in Los Angeles. Maybe the Union would give Chicago to the Confederates or whatever else, but not LA. It's too important. That's who we are. And it would only happen there, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's an interesting angle into it, you know, because you mentioned paranoia. And I actually have been tossing around this phrase in my head for a couple years, and I call it white picket paranoia, where you build this fence around your property because you do have this sort of underlying paranoia that people, I mean, hey, I'm all about privacy and respecting the privacy of other people. But at some point too, like, you have to realize you're cutting yourself off from your neighbors and your community. And that's not healthy in a lot of ways. And that's why I thought that the dystopia aspect of this really only, to me, was a surface level dystopia, because when you get into the book and the characters especially, it seems like some of the characters, despite being walled in this city, it seems like they find some comfort in that. Was that just me reading too much into it, or would you agree with that?
No, I totally agree with that. I found a lot of comfort in the walled in West Berlin. To me at the time, I came from West Germany, and living in West Berlin, the free Berlin, felt really like you lived in a place that was not Germany, even though it was, of course, German, but it was controlled by the Allied forces. And so even though everybody spoke German and it was in the heart of East Germany, the communist part, you felt you were on a totally different planet. It was its very own thing. And so the characters in Berlingeles who are living in Los Angeles, they love the walled-in part because they are all people who don't really have a visible existence. K is just waiting to be reunited with B, and he has to be very aware that thugs, if they knew that he has these very costly artificial limbs, would harvest them. They would just kill him and take those things off of him. And so he has to mimic an old, decrepit man, even though he could walk quite normally, in order not to draw attention to himself. Sophie, the 14-year-old prostitute, she only exists in the car that takes her from one client to the next. She's not a private person. She doesn't have any power, any agency. And she has a grandmother, a dead grandmother, but she is in the novel, and I actually quite love her. She always appears to Sophie, and she gives her advice. And she's kind of like, Sophie is talking to her grandmother Ida's ghost, and that ghost is the only person who offers her any advice or tries to better her lot at all. And then the young thug, Gaz, He only exists at night. He only comes out at night. And his biggest dream is to find the tunnel, because there's a maze of underground tunnels, which is actually real, under Los Angeles, all kinds of old subway tunnels, other tunnels, service tunnels that were built. And he is looking for the tunnel that, according to legend, leads either out to the sea or the other way outside of the city. And he's obsessed with the idea of finding that tunnel in the maze, this labyrinth of underground spaces. And that's what he's looking at. And so none of the people I describe in the book have a real public presence. And for them, the wall works perfectly to hide what they're doing. It's a shelter. They can do whatever they like because they don't have to be held publicly accountable for their actions.
Yeah, I have a couple things that I want to throw out here. The first is to talk more about that dystopian angle. And you mentioned how your students were writing it and why it appealed to them. You know, I don't know if you know the fiction author John Crowley. He's been a guest on the show a couple of times, and he just retired from teaching creative writing at Yale. And we had a chat a while back. His students were very much the same. They were very dystopian. A lot of the stories that they were writing were steeped in these dystopian settings and themes. And so he asked them to write a utopia, like what their ideal version of the future would be. And he said that the pervading or persistent theme throughout the utopian stories were that it was small groups of people that were secluded away from other groups of people that they didn't get along with. That was their vision of a utopia. And I thought, that's fucking crazy. Like, that's exactly what we don't need. That's not utopia. That seems like dystopia too. Just with a different, sort of mask on it, I guess.
Well, if you had just said now that his students wrote these utopian stories and they were exactly the same stories that they had written as dystopian stories, I would have believed that too. Because I think there's an aspect of adventure, of everything is possible, of no bureaucracy, of just pure living that pervades the dystopian streak, that we can more clearly focus on living instead of making a living. I mean, it's kind of like the dystopian novels set in America often look like Westerns in a weird sense, like small communities, small groups of people. They're the quote-unquote Native Americans, like, that come in and create havoc, and sort of as the enemy, they're not Native Americans, of course, anymore, but to show the parallel. And yeah, it's clearly a Western. It's a new form of writing clad in very old writing. And there's a kind of nostalgia for that, I think, looking back and looking forward and thinking, oh, if we have less people, we just might get along. Or if we didn't have to go to school, if we didn't have to go to work, if we didn't have to do that, but could just focus on survival, somehow that would make us feel better. And it's a very, very dangerous way of thinking to me, because it's escapist, and I think it's kind of self-destructive. But on the other hand, I think it's something that we have to take very seriously, because in my opinion, we're taking all the fun out of living right now in many, many ways, and largely because we want to feel safe. And I don't know exactly where it originates, but we're so obsessed with safety, from wearing bike helmets, from having organizing safe play dates for our kids. Like, we're trying to take any kind of danger out of our interactions, but it makes it so convoluted that we often don't feel we're actually alive. And that's a very dangerous situation. We saw that before the First World War, when European intellectuals were ready to go to war. They wanted to get rid of the old empires of the old order, because they were sick and tired of feeling stifled. And we can't allow that to become really the prevalent notion, that we have to get rid of everything. And we see that very clearly now, like, what the dangers are, because I think in the last two elections, how people are voting is they're voting for a savior. They're not voting for a politician, a manager kind of, who says, okay, we're going to do better here, we're going to do better there, we're going to manage everything, we're going to be good. But they're voting for someone they believe will come in and sweep it all clean and make it all better. And that's horrifying. And that's what has given us Trump. People who voted for Trump believe in him. It's not about him being a good politician, a good manager or something. It's about believing him. And we can't let ourselves be dragged down that road. It's horrifying. So we have to resist these impulses of glorifying this dystopian streak. And I feel and I hope that Berlingeles does that, that it shows a dystopia, but it's not reveling in it, because we don't see any redemptive streak. Nobody has a good time there. And people are suffering greatly. The characters might feel, yes, this is the place where they can live, but they're not living a happy life or a happy existence. And I don't think that readers will come away from the book thinking, oh shit, yeah, that'd be actually great, man. We should just get rid of everything and light out for the territory.
Well, I see, though, that is already happening. This self-policing of everything, I have a quote here, actually, that may add to this. So this is from your book. Kay often doubts what he knows. Inside L.A., it's hard to know what is true and what is a fabrication. and the fleece is of little help. You can see Atlanta burn, you can watch New York burn. Any given day, you can watch President Gray and President Blue declare a decisive victory, yet the wall still stands. End quote. And that is, as you mentioned earlier, actually, that is eerily reminiscent of the circumstances in present-day America, especially, where the internet is flooded with information. No matter what you believe in, there's information online that confirms your beliefs. There is news coverage tailored directly to you, and God forbid you associate with anyone who thinks or reads conflicting information, because then you're an asshole, and you get blocked on social media, as if that means anything whatsoever. And that's essentially self-policing. You're building your own wall, and not around your physical person necessarily, but around your mind. And that's a dangerous game to play. You know, what's more dangerous, I think, is some of the things happening in this apocalyptic dystopia, these themes that we've been talking about, they've already happened here, or they are happening. You know, like you mentioned in your book, there's a nuclear explosion in Texas that has really sort of unseen consequences. That's happened, you know, Google Fukushima. And then you have this immersion into the fleece, which is a virtual or an augmented reality. That's already happened. You know, go down to your local Best Buy. You can buy a headset right now and just immerse yourself in that sort of world. And then you have this idea of civil war, which, you know, maybe it's not happening here in a sort of hot way where there's groups that are being shown, you know, firing guns at each other or killing each other. But I mean, log on to Twitter. There's civil war going on. There's sides pitted against each other every day in this sort of shared virtual environment. It's all happening or has happened. So I don't know. I don't have a question on this. I just wanted to share that thought from that quote.
No, I think it's true. It is all happening. We're starting to happen. And I think Berlingeles shows you sort of the logical consequences of such behavior. It's taking a situation that we already feel is coming or happening to us and taking it to a higher level, to its logical conclusion, that this is how we're developing. Because if we really give up on even trying to find out what really happens, who is really right, if it's just a matter of believing one side or another, we become just little like sort of like playthings for people who tell us one thing or another. And we can't give up on reading up on what other people are saying. The discourse right now is so horrible because people always want to just win. They want to eviscerate the other side. They want to beat them up. They want to just kill them. And it's not about exchanging ideas anymore at all. It's just about yelling at each other and somebody will win and somebody will lose. And it's really a horrible, horrible situation. And we really have to pull back. We really have to not play as though this is the end of days, even though, of course, like we have to take care of very urgent business. But we have to allow other people to speak. We have to allow to be friends with people who don't think like us. And we have to let them speak. Because what we're seeing also right now, and this is a very gothic, awful moment, sort of the negative gothic moment, is that maybe like 4 years ago, I didn't even think the people who are now out in support of Trump even existed anymore in those numbers. I thought we had kind of moved beyond the question, should there be gay marriage or should there be abortion or all these things. I thought we had left that in the rearview mirror and we're moving forward. And now we're seeing that we just kept the lid on racism, xenophobia, homophobia, and that it festered under that lid and it's coming back to haunt us now. So what we were trying to put out was all the time was there, but we put it in dark places and so people were maybe not aware of it anymore, but it was there all along. And it wasn't addressed properly, and now we are dealing with the fallout of that.
Definitely, yeah. And before we go, I'd love for you to tell people where they can buy the book if they're interested, and then also where they can keep up with you and your work online across the internet and social media.
Absolutely. So you can buy it at any internet retailer. You can buy it at IndieBound. You can go to the big Amazon. It's all over the place. Everybody has it. And you can follow me at stefankiesbye.com. So that's my full name.com. And on Twitter, I'm SkySpy as Kiesbye, and you can follow me there too.
Awesome. Well, Stefan, I've loved this chat. I just absolutely adored the book, and I'm glad I actually sought it out after reading just one thing about it. I usually like to do my research when I invest my time into fiction, but here I was like, no, I'll just take the word of Meg Howry here. So I really do appreciate you being here. Look forward to chatting with you again sometime.
Thank you, Ryan. Thank you so much. That was really fun talking to you.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Stefan Kiesbye. And if you're into that whole cyberpunk dystopia with a touch of apocalypse, may I recommend Berlingeles. It is well worth the read. I mean, I do love me some stories drenched in these sorts of themes and environments, stories just dripping with paranoia. And this is, well, maybe it's not dripping with paranoia, but it's definitely got a paranoid flow that's comparable to the writing of PKD and Kafka and even guys like Thomas Pynchon, and I guess the films of David Lynch as well. But why do I like these sorts of stories? Why do we collectively migrate to stories like this? Maybe the answer lies in that opening topic that we broached, unhealed ancestral trauma. Are we just collectively losing our minds because that paranoia has been embedded into us? Do we just not know how to live any other way than with the thought that we're constantly on the brink of total and complete annihilation? Is this why the atmosphere and aesthetic and outlook and all our most popular fiction is always so gray and bleak? Obviously, these are rhetorical questions. Or maybe they're not. I don't know. I do know that in the Patreon extension, we talked more about the virtual and augmented reality, also got into a bit about religion and magic and divination, the future of the little things, and what pop culture may look like in the future. Also talked a little bit about lizard people and labyrinths under LA. And we close with Stefan choosing a city to wall himself in, and the three books that he'd take with him. Good stuff, if I may say so. And a shout out to new patrons, Andrew, Lex, Chaz, and Steven. Thanks for signing up to support the Esoteric Endeavor, and you too can join them by signing up at patreon.com/occulture. Four levels of support, varying rewards. And hey, one more thing before I go, 25% off all orders at occulturepodcast.com/merch now through November 26th. No discount code needed. Just go there, put the items in the cart, check out, 25% off, you got it. So grab a tee or a hoodie, wear it to your holiday get-togethers, let your family see how weird you are for listening to this podcast. Anyway, my time, this time, is up. So until next time, you've just been initiated into occulture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.